Well, hello everyone. Welcome to Enjoy the Music TV and enjoythemusic.com. Today we're really fortunate to have Professor Billy Drummond. He plays drums, he's played with legends, teaches at NYU in Juilliard. So let me just go ahead and, whoa, that was an explosion. Yes, welcome everyone. My name is Stephen Rochlin of enjoythemusic.com and enjoythemusic.tv, welcoming you to our interview with Billy Drummond. Let me just zoom in here a little bit and give you a little closer look. This is part of our musician series, and today, great guy. I've admired him, I've seen him play live. We're so fortunate, and he's a gentleman, he's a scholar. Let's go ahead and just bring him right on in.
Hi, Steve. Hi, everybody.
So love the picture behind you. You've played with greats like Sonny Rollins and on and on. Why don't you tell people a bit about you?
I'm a jazz drummer, basically, but I've played all kinds of music, and I've been playing the drums for well over 50 years now, I guess 53 years or so. And I feel very, very, very fortunate to have been able to eke out a living, I guess you could say, doing something that I absolutely love more than anything. And
you've played with some great cats like Sonny Rollins, Jay Moody, Pat Metheny.
Yeah, I've been very, very, very fortunate to have been able to rub shoulders with some of the greatest musicians of our time, or of any time, I would have to say. And, you know, some of them I never even dreamed that I would ever have played with, but, you know, luckily for me, I got a chance to, and they saw something in me and, you know, kind of let me spend some time with them on the bandstand and the recording studios, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm grateful for that. And I learned so much, and I'm still learning, just like I was then. And I hope to never stop. I still get a chance to play with great musicians every week, all the time. And
you share this love with others. I mean, why don't you tell them what you do with, like, Juilliard and NYU?
Well, I'm a professor of jazz drums at both schools. And so I teach private lessons. Every now and then I do ensembles. I've taught jazz history courses. But basically, you know, I teach private students. So mainly drummers, but, you know, bass players, guitar players, saxophone players, piano players, et cetera, come to me because they want the experience of playing with someone who's had a lot more experience than they have, so I can help them in that regard, and how they relate to playing in a group, how they relate to playing with a drummer, what I look for in another instrumentalist, et cetera, and then with the drummers, of course, it's sometimes it's nuts and bolts discussion, and sometimes it's just conceptual discussion, philosophical discussion.
There's a lot going on as a drummer because, you know, you're working as a core part of the rhythm section and you're keeping the flow going.
Yeah. Well, you have to be, the drummer is in a jazz ensemble, in a jazz group, and probably in any group, the drummer is really the leader, because whatever happens, time-wise, rhythmically, dynamically, the drummer can kind of be responsible for that. He can be in control of all that. So the drummer has to really have his ears and eyes and soul tuned into everything that's going on the bandstand, knowing the music, knowing the tempos, knowing how to support, knowing how to inspire, knowing how to react, and knowing how to just keep the things under control. And it's a great responsibility for the drummer, not only as a timekeeper, but also as an integral part of the improvisational process, you know. Mm-hmm. So lessons can consist of talking about all of these things. And some of the younger drummers don't know about that because they haven't had the chance to play with a lot of people in many different environments and different situations because just of, you know, where they are in their particular period of their life. Mm. So it's always I learn a lot from them, and hopefully they learn a lot from me.
And that is how it is a musician. We keep giving and we receive. It's a two-way communication for sure.
Exactly.
Now, you play with Gretsch drums, which are really nice. You have a nice, small, tight kit. Why don't you tell people about Gretsch?
Oh, okay. So Gretsch, I got turned on to Gretsch from my father, who was an ex-drummer by the time I was on the scene, born. But he's the one that turned me on to Gretsch. He always would tell me that he had Gretsch mm-hmm. broadcaster drums. When I started playing the drums, of course, I wasn't in a financial position to own any Gretsch drums for quite some time. So the drum sets that I had as a child growing up when I was 6 or 7 were various. At that time, the Japanese drum companies weren't as prevalent as they are today. In fact, most people that couldn't afford the name brand drums at that time in the 60s, which were Gretsch, Ludwig, Slingerland, Rogers,
yep,
etc., had to rely on drums, offshore drums, Japanese made drums, and they were badged with a bunch of different names: Kent, Stewart.
Yeah,
I remember some of the other ones. I had a set called Zimgar, which was the same category. I had a Tangerine Sparkle set of Zimgars, and then I got another set after that that just said "Made in Japan."
And that's it.
And these were drums that were probably made out of some wood that wasn't maple or birch or whatever at that time, or poplar. So. It wasn't until 1977, when I had been working at Busch Gardens. I was the drummer in the Festhaus band in Busch Gardens in Williamsburg, Virginia. I'm from Newport News, which is about half an hour's drive from Williamsburg, 40 minutes or so. So I had a summer job there on my summer breaks from
a paying gig?
The conservatory, exactly. I bought a set of hand-rubbed walnut Gretsch drums.
Beautiful.
And at that time, they were they were expensive at that time, but compared to today, they were a serious bargain. I always wanted Gretsch drums because all of my drumming heroes at that time had played or were playing
Gretsch.
Max Roach, Art Blakey, Elvin Jones, Tony mm-hmm. Williams, Lenny White, on and on and on. They all played Gretsch drums. And, I had some other idols, heroes that played other drums, but my main guys were those guys, the real the jazz guys. And so that's the sound that I always heard in my head.
And then we go to cymbals, if you don't mind me interrupting. Yeah. The classic Zildjian, been around literally forever, Turkish cymbals.
Yeah, well, the original K-Zildjians were Turkish.
Yes, and I've played a few of the originals.
Yeah,
they were
incredible. A lot of those as well from back in the day. But now they're insanely expensive if you can find one that's actually any good.
Yes, they are.
So, yeah, but I've been with the Zildjian company since probably 1997 or so. And this is a great company and a great family. And, of course, they are tied to the K Zildjian. It's all one family that has split up into different areas and stuff. Sabian, Zildjian, and then the Zildjian people in in Turkey. But that company is no more. The Zildjian,
the brothers. This is many years ago, and I know this story. They argued a bit over the ownership of the company, and so one got the Sabian name, right, and one got Zildjian.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, but yeah, they're great cymbals, and there's a lot of cymbals companies right now. When I was growing up, it was basically Zildjian
and everyone else.
Well, Zildjian.
Oh, and Pasty. Yes.
Pretty much that was it when I was growing up. But now there's guys making cymbals in their backyard and
all sorts of effects. Who knows?
Just came to me the other day with a cymbal that some guy had made in Brooklyn.
Huh. I don't know what
the guy's name is. And it wasn't bad. It was actually okay. So, you know, all that kind of stuff is popping up now. Just like the drum companies. There's so many drum companies that I've never heard of that
yes.
are making, you know, reasonably good drums, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Still, I've been playing Gretsch for so long. That's kind of the sound that I hear in my head when I hear.
Oh, they're great drums.
I want it to sound like the sound on the records that I grew up and that I still listen to. So that's my reason for playing Gretsch. Not that there's not other good drums out here. I have some other drums.
Oh, I understand. It's cool. Now, sticks, you and I play the same sticks, Vic Firth, mm-hmm. which I love, and he does more than sticks. He does mallets, he does
Russians.
A wide variety.
Mm-hmm.
So I love that they're tonally matched, that they do the weight. You probably remember, I should say, way back when, you know, you'd go to a drum store and you'd have to roll every stick hoping it was... You know, because they'd warp, and today they really have fine-tuned it, and Vic Firth is some great sticks.
Yeah,
what size do you play, if you don't mind me asking?
I play, they're called the SD11 Slammer.
Ah.
And they're a relatively large stick. I mean, most jazz drummers pick them up and go, wow, these are like baseball bats. My friend Kenny Washington always laughs at me with my sticks, because, you know, he's a great, great, great drummer and a dear, dear friend of mine, but... You know, he plays like a smaller stick. Most of the jazz drummers play a smaller stick.
Yeah, like a 5A. It's like ring size with cigars, for those who smoke cigars. And then when I was marching, I think we used, what was it, 3S's, which were like tree trunks.
Right, right. Yeah, well, most jazz guys use 5A's or 7A's or some mm-hmm. kind of smaller stick. But for me, the SD11, it feels good in my hands. It sounds good on the cymbals, and it's yep. got enough weight to sound good on the drums, you know.
And that's an important point, because I also play thicker sticks, and I find, because when you play, there's a fulcrum effect. I wish I had, and I find with a little more weight, I'm able to get a little more feel with them.
Yeah, I mean, everybody's different.
This is true.
That's why there's so many different sticks, you know. I prefer... This stick is made out of maple. I don't really like sticks that are made out of hickory or oak or any of that other wood. They just don't feel right. I like my drums made out of maple. So that's why I play Gretsch drums. They're maple. The sticks, Vic Firth, are maple. And that, to me, goes together.
Now, not only are you a professor, not only do you teach, not only do you play with bands and do studio work, should we tell our listeners that you're an audiophile? You've got high-end audio gear at home.
Yes.
What got you into that?
You know, I don't know. I'm from that era, as you are.
Mm-hmm.
That era, everybody had a stereo. It didn't matter if you were a musician or whatever. Everybody had a stereo. And at that time, the high end hadn't been hadn't been coined yet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my father had a Girard turntable. He had a Fisher receiver. He had KLH speakers.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, he used to read High Fidelity or whatever it is magazine. So that it was like. It wasn't a weird thing to go into somebody's house and see a stereo at that time. Now, if you go into somebody's house and see a stereo, you're almost taken aback. Because most people don't even have any kind of stereo. And most musicians that I know don't have a stereo.
Why do you feel that is, if you don't mind me asking?
I think they've been brainwashed somewhat by just the general society and consensus. You know, when CDs came out, everybody, you know, the industry basically said, oh, get rid of your old scratchy records, and, you know. And then, you know, so a lot of people got, you know, their turntables, they got rid of their records or their turntable, their stylus or their needle broke and they didn't know what to do. And then turntables started to disappear. Records started to disappear. CDs came in. And these people that did have stereos, these musicians, their stereos were aging. And so if something broke, if their amp fried or whatever, they just didn't bother. Then iPods came in, and downloading and streaming and all that kind of stuff just kind of intervened and pushed everything to the side or away completely, and they never recovered from it, I think, in most cases. But I think it's slowly but surely coming back, and I have several musician friends that I've had at my house, and I've let them hear my stereos, and they all perk up and go, I got to get new speakers. I have an amp. And then they start asking me, well, what speakers can I get at? You know, how much, you know, da 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 da, you know, because they're completely, they don't see it.
They don't know, because the high-end audio does a lackluster job at even making ourselves aware. I mean, everyone knows, like, Bentley, Ferrari, Rolls Royce.
Right.
Everyone knows Rolex. Yeah. Some people might know Patek Philippe, and on and on.
Right.
Now, let me just go ahead and bring up one of the things that you do. For some reason, my computer went a little whack there. You have audible illusions.
Yes.
Why don't you tell people about that?
Well, it's pretty much a no-nonsense. The model that I have doesn't have a remote. I have two models. I have two models of the Modulus 3A.
Mm.
One has the stepped attenuators, and one has the non-step. But
right.
It's a tube preamp, single-ended, high gain, and one of them has the gold board, the moving cartridge gold board, low output, and the other one has the moving magnet phono stage. So I like it. For the money, I don't think anything out there beats it in terms of sonics. And I think it can compete with preamps costing 2 to 3 times as much,
and then
sonically.
Right. And then for speakers, you have MagnaPan. Now, to make because we do have viewers that aren't familiar, it's actually a flat panel speaker, what's called a planner.
Right.
And you have, what is it, the 1/6s?
The 1/6 QR, yeah, quasi-ribbon, yeah.
Uh-huh. Nice. Right, yeah. So it's part ribbon, part dynamic.
No, it doesn't have...
That's
doesn't
right.
Have, it's just, it's not a full ribbon tweeter.
Ah,
I don't
that's
understand
right.
how it... You know, like if you go up into the next model, the 3.6 or the 3.
Which I've had, actually. I had the 3.6s. And let me tell you, wow.
Right. It's a great, I mean, once you hear a Maggie, it's hard to go back to listen to a conventional speaker because they're so open, they're so detailed.
Fast and clean.
Fast, and the soundstage and imaging is to die for.
Mm-hmm.
And it's completely non-fatiguing, and it's just a natural sounding speaker. It doesn't move air the same way that a conventional cone speaker would.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't do the same kind of bass, the same quality of bass as a cone speaker. But the bass that it does is very accurate and tuneful, in my opinion.
Yep. So you bring these musicians over. You have them listen to your stereo system,
mm-hmm.
and they're like, wait, what have I been missing?
Yeah, they are. I mean, you play a record that they've heard, you know, 100 times, and it's like they've heard it for the first time. Because they listen and they go, wow, I didn't know that Tony Williams' ride cymbal sounded like that, you know, because they've been listening to it on either a not a very good stereo or earbuds or computer speakers, and that's not a real accurate depiction of what's happening. And that was what drew me into high-end audio, was the fact that I could hear these recordings and I could hear the people that I liked, they're playing. I could really hear their sound. I could really hear Max Roach's drums. Mm. I could really hear Philly Joe Jones's drums and Tony Williams' cymbal and Billy Higgins' cymbal. You know, the whole thing. And
yeah,
you know,
and it's, I mean, even with, regardless, and I have some great headphones and I have about four or five pair of custom in-ears, there is something about using speakers, having a true, you know, we'll call it a three-dimensional space, this home stereo system, that is like being at a live performance. You get this true, you know, feeling, whether it's the sound, the vibrations in the air.
Yeah, that's it, exactly. You hear the sound of the speakers in a room, and it brings you closer to the venue, like the you are there, or they are here, you know, however you want to look at it, you know. So when I'm listening and all is right with the world, it's like Miles is standing right in front of me playing. So you know, that's a nice feeling, and once you get used to that, you can't settle for anything less.
Totally agree. So what else would you like to tell us today?
I'm open. I mean, I'm happy to be doing this.
Your next gigs? What you up to?
My next gigs, this weekend, I'm playing in Connecticut at a club called The Side Door with a great saxophone player, baritone saxophone player named Gary Somalian. And then this weekend, Saturday, I'm doing a record date with a great bass player named Mike Richmond.
And that would be Saturday,
February 19th or the 20th. I can't remember.
Something like that. Right. 2016 for those watching.
The Sunday, I'm doing another record date with a vocalist who I've never met. Well, I've met a couple of weeks ago, but I don't know her singing, but this is something that the record producer asked me to play on. And then, next week I'm playing, I'm excited about playing in trio with a group that we just released a new record last week on Chesky Records.
Oh, yes.
As you know, Chesky is an audiophile record label, but they're very, has a lot of artistic integrity in terms of what they record and put out. And this is a record with a cooperative group with myself, Javon Jackson, who's a great tenor saxophone player, and the great, legendary, iconic Ron Carter on the bass. And so we're playing at the Iridium on Wednesday.
Right, and the album is called?
The album is called We'll Be Together,
Again.
And the name of the band is Three's Company.
And that is available at hdtracks.com.
Right.
And it's also available in high resolution or high res audio or high res music, however you want to call it. So you can go there, pick it up. I do have a copy. I love it. I was listening to it earlier. I'm telling you, the sound quality, as good as CD is, and people are used to that, and for people who just sit and listen to MP3s, just for those listening out there, keep in mind, MP3 is lower quality than CD. They went there because of the whole internet thing and bandwidth. So you go to CD again for quality, and above that is like what HD Tracks did with your stuff. Now, I'm sure you hear a difference on your system.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
It's like Studio Master.
Yeah, it's very natural sounding.
Yes.
Of course, Chesky records in an unusual way, you know, in comparison to the way most records that you hear are recorded in a studio with people separated in booths and multiple miking. This recording was done with a dummy head microphone that hears as if it's
as if you're sitting in the audience listening, and then you guys just played naturally.
Right. Yeah.
And well, that's what it sounds like.
It's almost like you're sitting in the band, because the way we're set up is the dummy head is here, and the bass and the drums and the saxophone are surrounding. So you're hearing surround sound, but not in an artificial way, in a natural surround sound. I think they call it binaural.
Yes, that is correct.
If you do have a great set of headphones, it's actually quite quite good listening to it on that. If you have a pair of electrostatic headphones or really good dynamic headphones, it's quite good too. But on a full range stereo system with speakers and everything, it's really quite amazing to hear.
Startling in the realism.
The tonality of the instruments is very, very, very natural. So.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for your time. We really do appreciate it.
Okay. Thanks so much, Steve. And I really enjoyed this, and I enjoyed meeting you and talking to you, and I hope we can continue our conversations.
Oh, yes. And I definitely plan on stopping back up to New York at some point, maybe hanging out with you, buy a drink.
Come by the house and let's do some listening.
Yeah, but I'm also going to want to kind of get you to give me a lesson. I'll have to fork out some money for a good lesson. I could use a refresh.
We'll talk drums and audio, and it won't be a lesson. It'll just be conversation about the things that we love. How's that?
Perfect. Awesome.
Okay.
Thanks, man.
Okay. Thanks so much, Steve.
You're welcome.
See you later.
Yep. Bye-bye. Oh, that was really great. And so let me go ahead and just bring it back to me as I panic. That's one of the reasons why I wear glasses. Some people are like, Steve, see, he's laughing. They're like, Steve, why do you wear glasses? I'm like, you guys have no idea. I've got like four keyboards, a production studio console. Anyway, who cares? The bottom line, is who the heck am I? I don't know. There we go. There's my lower third. My name is Stephen Rochlin of enjoythemusic.com. And enjoythemusic.tv. And in the end, what really, really matters is that you enjoy the music. Let me give you guys some music.